seriously, I am going to stop for just a minute and do a little commercial at the beginning of the YouTube. And that is, somebody's going to, I know this already, somebody's going to be watching this at some point in time, and I believe it's going to be this week. And it's going to catch their curiosity of, I've heard about Church of Messiah. I've heard about them, and I'm wondering what they're all about. So out of curiosity, through social media, somehow or another, they found out that we now have a YouTube channel. I like to call it MyCOMTV. That's just me calling it that. MyCOMTV. But they're going to click on, and they're going to wonder what we're all about. And I want to tell them, also, there are going to be people who click on who used to be a part of us, who are curious. I wonder how they're doing. I wonder what's going on. And I want them to know that we are alive and well. And that Jesus is in our midst. And this table is still open, and our doors are open for you to come. And we would love to see you. Amen, congregation.
Amen.
All right, that's the commercial. Here comes the sermon. First, as you know, I've got to give you a little background because that's just who I am. Recently, I've come in contact with various groups of people, either at work or in personal relationships or even in family, that are really going through a time of struggle. And so I begin to pray, because that's usually what I do when I'm aware of a circumstance or a situation. I try my best to pray for the people who are involved or the circumstances of the situation. And one of the prayers that I always include is, God, show yourself strong. Because when you're in the middle of something, you, not only are you weak, but as we get weak, we think God is weak. Now, we know that's not true. Our brain knows that is not true. But our feelings, because we're having to go through the suffering, our feelings feel like our God is a little weak, or a little deaf, or just doesn't care. So as I began to pray for these circumstances and situations that are very similar in content, but different, completely different contexts, but very similar, the Lord gave me a word. And the word was, I don't mean a word of the Lord, I mean a word. And the word was, God, I want you to pray against the spirit of complacency. And I thought about that word for a minute, and I thought about the circumstances that I was praying about. I said, Lord, that's pretty good. Complain. I'm glad I agreed with God. But of course, I had to look it up. The definition of complacency is, and now listen to this, self-satisfaction accompanied by an unawareness of pending dangers or your own deficiencies. I said, Lord, that is good. That really applies to their situation. And he goes, I'm glad you like that. Now I want you to look up apathy. I said, wow. I'll look up apathy. Apathy, simply stated, is a lack of interest or concern. Now, I could identify in the circumstances that I was praying over both complacency and apathy. They were very applicable to the situations I was praying over. Very applicable. So I said, Lord, thank you for revelation knowledge. Thank you that you've shown me exactly what I need to pray. And now, God, I'm going to start praying against the spirit of complacency and apathy. And he goes, that's great, Scott. Let's start with you. What? That's great, Scott. Let's start with you. And I cannot tell you what happened to my heart at that moment when he spoke those words. It wasn't an audible voice. But it was the voice of God nonetheless. Let's talk about you first, Scott. Let's talk about your complacency and your apathy. Ah, wait a minute, God. Wait a minute. Uh-uh. You got me confused with maybe the other Scott. or another Scott. Notice he's not here today, but he will watch the YouTube. I just had to take the edge off. That was a heavy moment. I know it was. Trust me, it was a heavy moment for me. I said, God, how can I be complacent? Look at all the stuff I do. Look at everything I'm involved in. Look how many times I pray. Look how many times I counsel. Look how many times I lead worship. That does not sound like somebody who's complacent or apathetic. God said, look at your heart. And I looked at my heart, and I still didn't see it. And then he said, read Psalm 122. I only could get to the first line before I broke down in tears. I rejoiced when they said to me, let us go to the house of the Lord. I rejoiced when they said to me, let us go to the house of the Lord. Let me go to the place where I know God is going to meet me. Let me go to the place where there are other brothers and sisters that are going to hold me up. Let me go to the place where the lost can come and find the salvation that I know. And to be very honest with you, there are numerous times that as I'm driving here, I am not rejoicing. There are numerous times when I'm summoned to another meeting, rejoicing is the farthest thing that's coming out of my mouth. When I'm asked to counsel, or, hey, Father Scott, do you have a minute? Rejoicing is not part of the equation. Don't get me wrong. When I get here and I get around you, and I get around this table, and I get around to worship, rejoicing bubbles up. But it is not my first reaction. I've grown complacent. I've grown apathetic. I've been doing this for a long time, y'all. I've been doing this for a long time. When it comes to Christian life, Christian meetings, Christian church, Christian services, worship services, Bible studies. There's not much I haven't seen. There's not much that I haven't done. You know that Beaver Toyota lady? We're here to wow you. I don't get wowed too much going through the motions. I'm going to see the King of Kings. I'm going to see the Lord of Lords. I'm going to see the healer of my soul, my deliverer, my redeemer. There ought to be just a little bit more spring in my step and a little bit more anticipation in my heart. I hope y'all don't mind. I'm getting real honest here. I said, okay, Lord, what is it, and what do I do about it? Through another, when the Lord speaks to me, there's various ways the Lord speaks to me, by the way. It can be through your lips. You can just say something to me during a service that we're here together or in a meeting, and something will just hit me. One of these men will stand up here and declare the word of the Lord. And one thing that they say just kind of sticks with me. I hear God's voice. I read people's blogs and, Christian writers and stuff like that. Now, I read an interesting book and one line will just grab me and I can't get rid of it. Well, this is how this happened. During this period of time, I was reading someone who is a friend of this congregation, Tom Abbott, who likes to daily post his accountability and stuff like that. I like to be in touch with Tom and his entire family. I have a very special place in my heart. I'm going to go out to Texas and visit him one day when I don't mind getting dirty and working from dawn to dusk. Don't hold your breath. Don't hold your breath, Tom. You might be watching this one. But Tom said something that he was trying to reclaim, rediscover his call on his life. And he said the Lord took him to Revelations chapter 2. I'm going to read it in its entirety, but we're just going to stop, not the entire chapter. But we're going to stop at when the Lord stopped me. To the angel of the church in Ephesus write, "These are the words of him who holds the seven stars in his right hand and walks among the seven golden lampstands." Can we all agree Jesus is on the scene? This is Jesus walking among his churches, among his lampstands. "I know your deeds, your hard work, and your perseverance. I know you cannot tolerate wicked men, and you have tested those who claim to be apostles but are not, and have found them false. You have persevered and endured hardships for my name, and have not grown weary. Yet I hold this against you. You have forsaken your first love." I had to stop right there. What is the heart of my complacency and my apathy? I have forsaken my first love. Now, if we're not careful, and those of us who are married, we can really appreciate this. You can forsake your first love in your marriage. And I'm not talking the worst way, where you end up not loving each other anymore. I'm talking about the subtle way that we do it. See, Jesus didn't say, "You quit loving me." He didn't say that. He said, "You have forsaken your first love." Now, some scriptures say you have left or you have lost. Now, look at those of you, you know, Cindy and I will be married 43 years this year. 43 years. I double-dog anybody in this place to tell me I do not love my wife. You guys that know me, you see me interact with her, there's not a thing in the world I will not do for that woman. I absolutely love her. I love her more today than I did the first day I laid eyes on her. However, if I'm being truly honest, I don't woo her like I used to. I don't treat her like I treated her when I first fell in love with her. I don't. It's become comfortable. She knows what I'm going to say before I say it. She knows what I'm going to do before I do it. I don't know if I ever honestly in that relationship with her as my wife, I don't know if I could ever reclaim the passion and desire I had when we first started dating and when we first got married. I don't know if it's humanly possible.
Nothing's impossible.
But I do know that I sure can try and try to find out one way or the other. And I also know that it is spiritually possible. To reclaim that feeling, to reclaim that desire. Just because God tells me that I have left, lost, or forsaken my first love does not mean that He's saying, Scott, you don't love me anymore. Because I can honestly stand here before you and say, I love the Lord my God with all my heart, with all my soul, and with all my being. But I can absolutely also tell you that there are times when I don't feel Him like I used to. When I don't hear Him like I used to. And I get frustrated. And I get upset. And guess what else I start to do? I start looking around everywhere else, everything else, and try to figure out what the problem is. Or who the problem is. When God is searching me, and He's saying, Scott, you clean up your house and I'll take care of them. There are so many stories I could tell you of the glory and presence of God that I have had the honor to observe. Some right in this building, some right with you. And I'm honestly telling you that I am praying every day, Lord, restore that first love in me. Restore that first love in me. I want to fall in love with you all over again. Father Ed, 2 weeks ago, taught on baptism. When we entered those baptismal waters, everything that was past was gone. Behold, all things are new. Not because of us, not because of the water, but because of Jesus. Father Looker constantly reminds us, every time we come to this table, we are partaking in the very presence of God through the body and blood. Every time. Father Lon constantly has reminded us that we are to be witnesses of God's love. Well, I got to love Him first and foremost in order for me to have anything to testify about. It starts with me. Church, I want you to hear something. There is absolutely nothing. Absolutely nothing. In fact, I want you to say that with me. Absolutely nothing that we can do to get more of God in our service. There is absolutely nothing we can do to get more of God in our life. When Christ died on that cross, He said, "It is finished." When He came out of the grave, the last enemy was defeated. Yeah. No, there's nothing, there's no prayer, there's no worship song, there's no way to hold your head or what you wear that's going to bring more of God in this place. We can't get any more of God. He is fully here. He is all here. The healing God is here. The restoring God is here. The redeeming God is here. The saving God is here.
Amen.
We just need to clear our sight so we can see it. We need to reclaim our first love when everything was new. Wow, Jesus loves me. Wow, Jesus wants to heal me. Wow, Jesus wants to restore me. He wants to do this. He wants to do that. Do you remember how that felt? You could not tell people about it. You had people coming up to you. I had people coming up to me. My goodness, what's going on? You're just shining. I haven't been shining much lately. God, polish me off. Put the shine back on me. Put your word back in my mouth. Put your heart back in me. Church, there is unfinished business. We have unfinished business for the kingdom of God.
Amen.
And each one of us play an important role in what that business is. May God give us the heart to discern it, the ears to hear it, the eyes to see it, and the courage to reclaim it.
Thank you, Lord.
Amen. In the name of the Father, Son, and the Holy Spirit.
Amen.
Amen.
Hey, this is Father Scott Looker with Church Messiah. Thanks for watching our video. If you enjoyed it and you got something out of it, please click the like button below. And also, you can click the subscribe button to get notifications in your inbox when we post other videos in the future. You can click the little bell below and you'll get notifications also. So do that, and we'd appreciate it. So thanks. God bless you. We appreciate it. Pray for us, and we'll be praying for you. God bless you.